Honorable Ms. Justice Cheryl Austin, Judge, Court of Common Pleas, 38th Judicial District of Pennsylvania, Norristown, USA. May I welcome you on the stage, ma'am? Honorable Mr. Justice Nazrul Islam Chowdhury, High Court Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh. Please, sir, welcome. Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdom, may I request you to please join our distinguished panelists? Please join me in welcoming our President and Chief Operating Officer, Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdon. With the permission of the chair, of the chief guest, and the guest of honor, I'll proceed with the program. I would like to invite Honorable Mr. Justice Dimitar Tukushev, the President of the Constitutional Court of Bulgaria, to please address the gathering. Every distinguished speaker is given a 10 minutes time for their address.
Dear Mr. Gandhi,
уважаеми колеги,
dear colleagues,
дами и господа,
ladies and gentlemen,
участници в 16-та международна конференция,
dear participants in the 16th International Conference of Chief Justice of the World.
За мен е голяма чест и удоволствие като българин да бъда във вашата страна и тук.
For me, it's a great honor and pleasure as Bulgarian people to be in here in your great country, to be in Lucknow as participant in this authoritative forum.
Аз съм за първи път във вашата голяма държава.
I am on the first time here.
Известна като древна цивилизация.
In your great country, which is famous with her ancient civilization, rich history,
богата със своята история и култура,
and culture,
място, в което общуват различни религии,
the place where many different religions live together.
За тези няколко дни,
for those few days,
които сме тук с госпожа Еникова,
where we and Mrs. Еникова and I am, we are here. We felt warm and hospitality of people of this beautiful country.
Част от темата, която се дискутира в тази зала през, през следващите дни е обединяването на света в името на децата, като разбиране, което осигурява щастливо детство в едно толерантно, хуманно и справедливо общество.
The part of topic of the conference, which we will be discussing of those few days, is dedicated of the unification of the world for children, exactly providing happily and human development and society and development of society.
Това според мен може да се постигне само по пътя на утвърждаването на върховенството на закона, който въплъщава в своето съдържание човеколюбие, милосърдие и хуманизъм, съобразно стандартите, установени от Организацията на Обединените нации.
We can achieve humanism and justice only with establishing of rule of law, only with international democratic standards and according to UN.
Прекрасният концерт вчера.
Being mankind are so horrendous that they defy human acceptance. In my own country, Guyana, which sits on the northeast shoulder of the South American continent, our western neighbor, Venezuela, has resuscitated a claim to almost two-thirds of our country. That claim had been settled since the year 1899 by arbitration. And Venezuela has, since that time, seemingly acquiesced in the marking of the boundaries. But within the past weeks, Venezuela has amassed troops on our western border and has assembled sophisticated military hardware in its spurious claim against a poor developing country. I offer those two examples as examples of the existence of war and the threat of war. That is really the state of the world, so amply illustrated by the presidents of the former presidents of Croatia and South Africa this morning. In this state of the world, therefore, our attention must be focused on India, on Dr. Jagdish Gandhi, the students of the City Montessori School, and Article 51 of the Constitution of India. The City Montessori School, led by Dr. Gandhi, has been championing the welfare of the children of the world and contend that the achievement of world peace would substantially benefit the well-being of the world's children. The platform of their efforts is Article 51 of the Constitution of India. And if you look above you, I recall it's on both sides, towering in the ceiling. Article 51, among its provisions, states, and I refer to paragraph 1, the state shall endeavor to promote international peace and security. I submit that if ever there was an opportune moment for India to promote international peace and security, it is now. In the United States, during a recent congressional hearing, the Assistant Secretary of State for South and Central Asia said that, quote, India was driving energy and optimism across South Asia, and that the United States and India were now indispensable partners in the Indo-Pacific region to promote peace and stability. End of quote. On the eve of the visit of the Prime Minister of India to the United States recently, an Assistant United States Secretary of State for Military Affairs is reported to have said that India has grown in global stature and that that augured well for world peace. So when we look at Article 51, we see that India today is constitutionally enjoined to endeavor to promote international peace and security. It is not Guyana or Poland or Uganda or the judges assembled here who are charged with that responsibility under the Indian Constitution. It is India herself as the state. The founding fathers of India felt that India itself should carry that responsibility. And so my view is that Dr. Gandhi and the students of the City Montessori School are on track in that these conferences in which judges from around the world participate serve essentially to heighten the consciousness and awareness of India's constitutionally defined role, that is, the promotion of international peace and security. I have, in the past, lamented the fact that there was considerable talk flowing from these conferences with little progress on the achievements of the conference objectives. I have, however, since my arrival at this conference, had an opportunity for a rethink and for reflection. I was more than delighted to read in this year's conference brochure about the establishment of a follow-up committee, which will be principally tasked with pursuing the implementation of conference resolutions and decisions. I take the opportunity of commending the organizers for this initiative. That apart, however, there have been two other notable developments. First, it was heartening to read a report in the Economic Times of India last September that the Prime Minister of India, the Honorable Narendra Modi, said at a meeting of G4 countries, that is India, Brazil, Japan, and Germany, that these countries, quote, stood firm on ensuring global peace and security, end of quote. The Prime Minister was further quoted as saying that the world today was fundamentally different from the period when the United Nations was born, and that it is now faced with complex challenges. Prime Minister Modi also called for reform of the United Nations Security Council and expressed the view that the Security Council should include the world's largest democracies, representing the voices from all the major continents of the world. Those who have followed these conferences would be aware that reform of the United Nations Security Council has been a consistent call. I myself, on occasions, face questions from the student body on my own views about whether I felt that there was a need for reform of the United Nations Security Council. I cite these examples to you to say that perhaps, like me, you might have felt that the achievements of this conference were not forthcoming. But very slowly, if you pay attention to the developments around the world, you can see the change is coming. And significantly, very significantly, coming out of the last United Nations session, attended by the Prime Minister of India, we note that the Prime Minister is taking his government into a leadership role on the world platform will result in success. In the United States, he has done considerable work aimed at the establishment of a World Court of Human Rights, for which I warmly congratulate him. As I near the end of my presentation, there is one final point I would like to address. It touches directly upon the Constitution of India, that is Article 51 and the fundamental rights provisions in that Constitution. The Supreme Court of India, in relation to the question of the standing of the directive principles of state policy, of which Article 51 forms a part, and the fundamental rights provisions, has settled the question with the determination that the fundamental rights provisions of the Constitution hold primacy over the directive principles of state policy. The distinguished Indian constitutional lawyer, H.M. Sirvai, has posited that the directive principles serve to complement the fundamental rights provisions. Judicial pronouncements from the Supreme Court of India have made it clear that Article 51 and other directive principles are non-justiciable and therefore unenforceable. But I have, at this forum in the past, pointed to the use of imperative language in Article 51. And it could by no means be said that the provisions of Article 51 are to be regarded as meaningless surplusage. While I readily admit that I am no expert on Indian constitutional law, I submit for consideration that every citizen of India enjoys the fundamental entitlement to life. Global peace and security significantly assures the enjoyment of that right. So that in a world of global conflict and instability, there is a real threat to the right to life. Therefore, if India were to proactively promote the issue of international peace and stability, it could hardly be said that such an engagement by India did not complement the fundamental right to life. I don't know if I'm right, but I throw it out for consideration. I also respectfully submit that such a proactive engagement by India is something that it is constitutionally enjoined to do. In concluding, I only wish to say to my colleague judges present here today that the students of the City Montessori School expect our support in their appeal for a safer world, and we should not fail them. Thank you very much.
The President, Judge, Counselor at Court of Cassation in Lebanon, for making a gift of a token of gratitude to Dr. Jagdish Gandhi, Mrs. Gandhi, and Professor Geeta Gandhi Kingdon. Since Professor Geeta, oh, thank you so much. So, please. And the message, you want to read the message? Mike?
شرفني وزير العدل اللبناني جنرال أشرف ريفي أن يعتذر عن عدم حضوره ويقدم أطيب تحياته للمؤتمر بالنجاح سيما في ضوء مسيرته التي يعني تسير عليها عائلة غاندي ومدرسة CMS.
On your lordship, the Chief Justice of Lebanon, my Nabil Sariji, I accept it with humility. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So this was a gift on behalf of Major General and Honorable Minister of Law and Justice of Lebanon, Mr. Ashraf Rafi. Thank you. Professor Geeta Gandhi, would you like to share a few words at this moment?
I just thought that Justice Carla Shook's points, they've been very encouraging. I just wanted to summarize the three main points as I understood them for the students. One is that India is on track towards providing leadership in the area of global peace and security. The fact that it is expected of India that it will provide moral leadership to the world. So as he started off by saying that India's this effort of CMS is on its way to fulfilling some of that expectation. But at the national level, the fact that our Prime Minister is standing firm on the global peace and security agenda going out to many countries of the world. Secondly, the call for the creation of a World Court of Human Rights. The fact that there are organizations now that are working actively to promote that cause, that also, you cited that as a reason that gives one hope, that it is not a vain hope. It is an actionable agenda. It is indeed feasible, and that can happen. And thirdly, the provision of the Article 51 of the Constitution of India, it is not just a directive principle of state policy that is unenforceable, that it is almost legally right to call it a fundamental human right, to proactively work to promote peace on earth. So I just wanted to emphasize that for the children.
Thank you so much. Yeah. That was so well done. Thank you. I'm sure that this has been very helpful to the children, and hopefully you will also have a chance of interacting with His Honor in the course of the interactive sessions or the parallel sessions. I would now like to invite Honorable Mr. Brajesh Mishra, senior editor, ETV Uttar Pradesh, to come and address us on this whole issue of promoting gender equality. May I request the students to garland, sir?
नमस्कार बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सबसे पहले तो मैं मंच पर मौजूद अपने सम्मानित अतिथियों का उत्तर प्रदेश के लखनऊ में बहुत स्वागत करता हूं विभिन्न देशों से आए हुए तमाम हमारे सम्मानित अतिथिगण हिज एक्सीलेंसी तमाम मौजूदा और पूर्व जज महोदय लखनऊ के तमाम सम्मानित अतिथिगण देश विदेश से आए हुए तमाम हमारे दोस्तों और CMS के की टीचर्स और CMS के छात्र छात्राएं बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया और धन्यवाद मुझे यहाँ पर आमंत्रित करने के लिए सबसे पहले तो मैं ऐतिहासिक कार्यक्रम के लिए डॉक्टर जगदीश गांधी को बहुत आभार व्यक्त करना चाहता हूँ कि उन्होंने एक ऐतिहासिक कार्यक्रम उत्तर प्रदेश की राजधानी लखनऊ में आयोजित किया है और ये हमारे लिए बहुत गर्व का विषय है कि किसी प्रांत में वो भी उत्तर प्रदेश जैसे प्रांत में इस तरह का इंटरनेशनल इवेंट आयोजित किया जाए मुझे लगता नहीं कि ऐसा कोई उदाहरण विश्व के किसी अन्य स्टेट में आपको मिलेगा जहां पर बहुत कम रिसोर्सेस के बावजूद एक ऐतिहासिक सम्मेलन करना ये अपने आप में बहुत 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 बड़ी बात है और ये कोई सामान्य बात नहीं है बल्कि मैं इसको मानता हूं कि एक असाधारण प्रयास है ये एक ऐसा भागीरथी प्रयास है जिसके लिए डॉक्टर जगदीश गांधी की हम सबको खुले मन से सराहना करनी चाहिए कि उन्होंने लखनऊ में इस तरह का आयोजन करके लगातार 16वीं बार एक इतिहास कायम किया है जिस तरह के रिसोर्सेज और माहौल में हम लोग रहते हैं उस माहौल के बावजूद इस तरह के एफर्ट करना दुनिया भर के राष्ट्राध्यक्षों को तमाम सम्मानित जज महोदयों को और बहुत से डिप्लोमैट्स को एक स्थान पर वो भी लखनऊ में आमंत्रित कर लेना ये अपने आप में बहुत बड़ा चैलेंज है हम सब एक शहर में 300 लोग इकट्ठे नहीं कर सकते बड़ी मुश्किलें होती हैं लेकिन ये दुनिया भर के लोगों को जो भी बहुत सम्मानित और अपने क्षेत्र के एक्सपर्ट हैं उनको लखनऊ में इकट्ठा कर लेना और एक विषय पर किसी कंक्लूजन पे पहुंचना ये कोई सामान्य बात नहीं है हम सबको इसके लिए डॉक्टर जगदीश गांधी से सीख लेनी चाहिए और मैं विशेष तौर पर धन्यवाद प्रोफेसर गीता गांधी किंगडम का भी दूंगा चीफ ऑपरेटिंग ऑफिसर हैं बहुत ही सक्सेसफुली इवेंट को ऑर्गेनाइज कर रही हैं दोस्तों मुझे निर्देशित किया गया है कि मैं जेंडर इक्वालिटी पर कुछ अपनी बातें रखूं इस बात को कहने में मुझे कोई परहेज नहीं है सबसे पहले तो हमें यह समझना चाहिए व्हाट इज जेंडर इक्वालिटी लैंगिक समानता विषय है क्या बहुत साधारण सी बात है लैंगिक समानता का वो विषय है कि जहां पर हम महिलाओं को समान अवसर शिक्षा का हो समान अवसर उनके रहन सहन का हो समान अवसर उनको फूड्स में मिले समान अवसर उनको प्रॉपर्टी में मिले और किसी भी क्षेत्र में काम करने के लिए उनको बहुत समान अवसर जो लोगों को अवेलेबल होता है वो मिले इसको हम जेंडर इक्वालिटी कहते हैं लेकिन जब हम भारत के दृष्टिकोण में और खासतौर पर अपने प्रदेश के दृष्टिकोण में इस बात को देखते हैं तो कुछ महत्वपूर्ण बातें हैं जो मैं आपसे शेयर करना चाहूंगा आज भी हमारे देश में जब किसी के घर बेटा पैदा होता है तो बहुत उत्सव मनाया जाता है बहुत खुशियां मनाई जाती हैं लेकिन आज 21वीं सदी में होने के बावजूद डिजिटल एरा में होने के बावजूद जब किसी के घर में बेटी पैदा होती है आज भी भले ही हमारे प्रोग्रेसिव थॉट्स कहीं हो लेकिन वो हमारे एक्शन में दिखता नहीं और जब बेटियां पैदा होती हैं तो उतनी खुशियां नहीं मनाई जाती यानी डिस्क्रिमिनेशन हम उसके पैदा होने के पहले से शुरू कर देते हैं तो जेंडर इक्वालिटी की बात करना कम से कम हमारे देश के परिप्रेक्ष्य में शायद अभी उतना प्रभावी नहीं है बात भले ही 21वीं सदी की हो रही हो हम हिंदू धर्म में भले ही ये बात कही जाती हो कि हम देवी मानते हैं महिलाओं को उनकी पूजा करते हैं पर क्या ये हमें सोचने की जरूरत है कि क्या जो हम सोचते हैं जो हमारे धार्मिक विचार हैं और जिस तरह का हम परसेप्शन रखते हैं क्या हमारे एक्शन में दिखता है क्या वो एक्शन में नहीं दिखता हम भले ही ये मानते हैं कि महिलाएं हमारे लिए देवी हैं इसको डबल स्टैंडर्ड कहते हैं मैक्सिमम इंडियंस को आप देखेंगे उनकी बातें कुछ हैं, मैं किसी व्यक्ति विशेष या किसी कम्युनिटी पे नहीं जाना चाहता, लेकिन जेंडर इक्वालिटी की हम बातें तो बहुत करते हैं लेकिन वो हमारे एक्शन में नहीं दिखती है, हमारे विचारों में नहीं दिखती है, हमारे कार्यों में नहीं दिखती है। जब हम महिलाओं को अधिकार देने की बात करते हैं तब हम प्रैक्टिकल में वो करके देते नहीं है। नतीजा क्या है, सिर्फ इस तरह की मीठी मीठी बातें होती हैं और उसको हम एक्शन में इंप्लीमेंट नहीं करते। अभी हाल ही में इंटरनेशनल मॉनेटरी फंड के प्रमुख क्रिस्टिन लागार्डे ने एक बहुत महत्वपूर्ण बात कही, अभी हाल ही में जो समिट हुई, कि अगर भारत में लैंगिक समानता और महिलाओं को काम करने के अवसर पुरुषों के बराबर अगर मिले तो भारत की जो जीडीपी है 27% उसमें ग्रोथ हो सकता है। ये कोई सामान्य बात नहीं है। कहने का मतलब यह कि जितनी तादाद में पुरुष भारत में काम करते हैं उतनी तादाद में महिलाओं को यहां काम का अवसर नहीं है। यह हैरान करने वाली बात है। जिस देश को अपनी जीडीपी की चिंता नहीं हो, अगर आप महिलाओं को काम का अवसर देंगे इस देश में, अगर पुरुषों के बराबर लाकर खड़ा करते हैं तो इस देश की जीडीपी बढ़ेगी। हम विकास की बातें करते हैं, हम मेक इन इंडिया की बातें करते हैं, मेक इन यूपी की बातें करते हैं, पर हम जेंडर इक्वालिटी की बातें कब करेंगे? महिलाओं को हम प्रॉपर्टी में अधिकार देने से क्यों हिचकते हैं? उनको क्या हम बेटर एजुकेशन दे पा रहे हैं? नहीं दे पा रहे। आज भी हमारे यहां जब एजुकेशन की बात होती है तो बेटों को ज्यादा अच्छी शिक्षा दी जाती है, क्योंकि यह माना जाता है कि इनका इन्वेस्टमेंट का रिटर्न मिलेगा। अगर महिलाओं बच्चियों को पढ़ाया जाएगा, गर्ल्स को, तो शायद उसका इन्वेस्टमेंट अच्छा नहीं माना जाता इस देश में। क्यों? क्योंकि वो शादी के बाद दूसरे घर चली जाती है। इस तरह की धारणा वाला देश है। तो इस धारणा को बदलने की जरूरत है। ये धारणा जब बदलेगी तब इस देश की सही मायनों में तरक्की होगी। भले ही आज हम मेक इन इंडिया, मेक इन यूपी कैसी भी बातें कर लें, लेकिन ये तरक्की आपको तब मिलेगी जब आप लैंगिक समानता पर आएंगे और महिलाओं को उनके अवसर देंगे, जो शायद अभी भारत में नहीं हो पा रहा है। और ऐसा सिर्फ किस तरह का माहौल मिले, किस तरह की शिक्षा मिले, ये भी तो देखने की आवश्यकता है। भारत जैसे देश, ये हमारे लिए आज बहुत ही शर्मनाक बात है कि 141 देशों में भारत का नंबर लैंगिक समानता में 127 पे है। आपसे ज्यादा अच्छा परफॉर्म आयरलैंड जैसे छोटे देश कर रहे हैं, लेकिन हमारे देश में सिर्फ मीठी बातें होंगी, उसको एक्शन में इंप्लीमेंट नहीं करेंगे। और जिस देश में 60 करोड़ वीमेन्स रहती हैं, महिलाएं रहती हैं, और उनमें भी 38 करोड़ वोटर्स हैं जो अपने वोट का इस्तेमाल करती हैं, आप इमेजिन करें कि जिस तरह की पॉलिटिक्स इस देश में होती है, अगर ये महिलाएं सब एक हो जाएं तो मुझे लगता नहीं कि सत्ता तो उन्हीं के पास होगी। तो ये वक्त ऐसा है कि हमको अपने एक्शन में उसको तब्दील करके देना पड़ेगा। जेंडर इक्वालिटी की बात हम तभी सही मायनों में इंप्लीमेंट कर पाएंगे। आज भी इस देश में हम लोग भले ही लखनऊ में रहते हो, दिल्ली रहते हो, मुंबई रहते हो, लेकिन जब भी आप ग्रामीण क्षेत्र में जहां वास्तविक भारत बसा हुआ है वहां जब आते हैं तो आप किस तरह का डिस्क्रिमिनेशन देखते हैं महिलाओं के प्रति। उनको ठीक से खाना तक नसीब नहीं होता, उनको एक अच्छी डाइट तक नहीं मिलती, जबकि बेटों के लिए हर तरह के व्यंजन पकवान सारी चीजें उपलब्ध होती है, लेकिन गर्ल्स को क्या मिलता है? जो उनसे बच जाता है। तो इनइक्वालिटी तो आपने वहीं से शुरू कर दी। तो वक्त इस बात का सोचने का है कि आप सिर्फ बातें ही ना करें, हम लोग सिर्फ कंसेप्ट तक ही मत रखें, डबल स्टैंडर्ड ना रखें, और महिलाओं के प्रति हम अपनी धारणा बदलें, उनको काम के समान अवसर उपलब्ध कराएं, और ये सोचें कि अगर उनका कंट्रीब्यूशन समाज और सोसाइटी के प्रति बढ़ेगा तो उसका फायदा देश को भी होगा, प्रदेश के लिए भी होगा। और क्या चीजें हो सकती हैं जिनसे जेंडर इक्वालिटी को बढ़ावा मिले, लैंगिक समानता को हम और बढ़ावा दे सके? हमें महिलाओं की रिस्पेक्ट करना सीखना चाहिए। तमाम ऐसे प्रांत हैं, तमाम ऐसे शहर हैं, अगर आप उदाहरण के तौर पर देखें तो सार्क कंट्रीज में ही आपकी कितनी पुअर पोजीशन है महिलाओं को लेकर इंडिया की। आप हैरान होंगे कि सार्क कंट्रीज में पाकिस्तान आपसे बेटर है महिलाओं के जेंडर इक्वालिटी में, बांग्लादेश आपसे बेटर है, आपकी पोजीशन सिर्फ अफगानिस्तान से बेहतर है। ये सिर्फ सार्क कंट्रीज की बात है। तो ये वक्त सोचने का है और सोचने के बाद उसको अपने एक्शन में इंप्लीमेंट करने का है, क्योंकि इस बात को हल्के में नहीं लिया जाना चाहिए जो आईएमएफ के चीफ ने कहा कि अगर भारत महिलाओं को काम के समान अवसर उपलब्ध कराता है तो उसकी जीडीपी 27% बढ़ेगी। 27% बढ़ने का मतलब आप चाइना से बहुत आगे होंगे। तो जो लोग विकास की बात करते हैं उनको ये बात नहीं भूलनी चाहिए कि विकास सिर्फ किसी एक या दो व्यक्ति पर नहीं निर्भर है, विकास सिर्फ लीडरशिप पर निर्भर नहीं है, विकास इस देश के पुरुषों और महिलाओं पर भी निर्भर है, और सिर्फ पुरुषों पर भी निर्भर नहीं है। इस देश में 60 करोड़ महिलाएं हैं, अगर उनमें से आप ये मानकर चले कि 40% काम करती हैं, 60% काम करती है और उनको काम के अवसर उपलब्ध कराए जाते हैं तो इस देश में क्या माहौल होगा? तो ये वक्त ऐसा आ गया है कि हमें इस वक्त पे थोड़ा विचार करना चाहिए, क्योंकि हमारा जो सोशल स्ट्रक्चर है खासतौर पर अपने देश और प्रदेश का, उसमें हम डबल स्टैंडर्ड अपनाते हैं, अपने लिए कुछ, महिलाओं के लिए कुछ। पैदा होने के पहले से लेकर जीवन के अंतिम दिन तक लगातार डिस्क्रिमिनेशन, उनके अधिकारों का हनन, उनके प्रति हिंसा, लगातार ये भावना रहती है। हमेशा ही कहा जाता है कि बेटियों को पिता के संरक्षण में रहना चाहिए जब शादी नहीं हो, शादी हो जाती है तो पति के संरक्षण में रहना चाहिए, और जब बुजुर्ग हो जाते हैं तो बेटों के संरक्षण में रहना चाहिए। यानी जीवन शुरुआत से लेकर अंत तक महिलाओं को इंडिपेंडेंट न किया जाना ये भारतीय संस्कृति का हिस्सा है। तो अब तो वक्त है ना कि इस संस्कृति में हम बदलाव लाएं। 21वीं सदी में आप डिजिटल युग की बात करते हैं, आप महिलाओं को समान अधिकार देने की बात करते हैं, पर दे तो नहीं रहे ना। तो इस कॉन्फ्रेंस के माध्यम से मैं डॉक्टर जगदीश गांधी का भी ध्यान आकृष्ट करना चाहूंगा कि इस कॉन्फ्रेंस के माध्यम से डॉक्टर गांधी ये मैसेज जाना चाहिए कि हम जेंडर इक्वालिटी की बात बहुत करते हैं, बट अब वक्त है उसको एक्शन में तब्दील करने का। सिर्फ मीठी बातों में बात नहीं बनेगी। वक्त हालांकि बहुत कम है, मैं इस पे कुछ और भी बातें थी, शायद कभी फिर मौका मिलेगा। डॉक्टर गांधी इस तरह के अद्भुत शानदार और ऐतिहासिक कार्यक्रम करते रहते हैं, मैं उनके प्रति आभार व्यक्त करता हूं और सम्मानित अतिथियों के प्रति भी आभार व्यक्त करता हूं और आप सबके प्रति भी। और अगर मुझसे जुड़े कुछ क्वेश्चंस होंगे तो मैं उसका जवाब भी दूंगा। मैं यहाँ एक टेलीविजन चैनल ईटीवी उत्तर प्रदेश के लिए काम करता हूं और पिछले 18 सालों से मैं इंडियन जर्नलिज्म के क्षेत्र में हूं, तो जो थोड़े अनुभव हैं मेरे मैंने वो अपने आपसे शेयर किए, और मुझे उम्मीद है कि इस कॉन्फ्रेंस के माध्यम से डॉक्टर गांधी ये बात जरूर जाएगी। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया मुझे यहाँ पर आमंत्रित करने के, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
As you mentioned, it's a time for action. There has been a lot of talk and discussion about gender equality.
We're running out of time, but I think I should briefly translate this for those guests who could not hear it.
Yes.
Who could not? Is that
yes,
okay?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Okay, with your permission, with the president's permission. So, Mr. Brijesh Mishra, editor of ETV, said he welcomed their esteemed guests. He says, very thanks for inviting me and for organizing such a historic, fabulous conference in the city of Lucknow and in the state of UP. Surely it is absolutely rare and highly significant to have organized such a gathering of eminent luminaries under one roof to deliberate on such an important topic, and that we must learn from Dr. Jagdish Gandhi. He said he's been asked to speak on gender equality. He said, normally we mean by gender equality the equality of opportunity for the two genders, but that in India the realities are quite different. When a boy is born, there's a lot of celebration. Discrimination begins before birth. The same joyful welcome is not accorded to a baby girl. We profess on the one hand that women are goddesses, women are equivalent of female gods, but we do not put into practice what we profess. We must not be hypocrites. We must not apply double standards. He quoted Christine Lagarde of the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, the chief of the IMF, and he quoted her as saying, citing a study which says that India's GDP, gross domestic product, India's income, could increase by 27% if there was gender equality in terms of women's and men's labor force participation rates. India is foregoing massive amount of economic growth on account of failing to give gender equality in the labor market and in terms of remuneration to women. Also failing to give gender equality in terms of education. There is an asymmetry in parents' incentives to invest in girls and boys, in sons and daughters, and that this must be overcome through change in attitudes and through governmental action. He said that India is in a shameful 127th position in the international ranking of countries on the parameter of gender equality. If women could unite as voters, they would most certainly be able to win for themselves gender equality, because then governments would have to pay attention to this topic. It's time to stop talking merely about it, to merely talk about it, and start to implement it. This is the time that has come. In our social structure, we adopt double standards, discrimination, violence against women, keeping them dependent on fathers when they are young and on brothers or husbands when they are older. And all of this must change. So his great call to all the students of City Montessori School and all the policymakers, whether it's in the legal domain or whether it's in the domain of politics and lawmaking or law enforcing and implementing, his call is that everybody actually stops to think about their own actions and see to it that they are both in terms of their own personal private conduct and attitudes, and in terms of the policy making, and in terms of the judgments indeed that are given by legal personalities, that gender equality is actually implemented instead of only being talked about. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much for that transfer. I was not very conscious of the fact that the whole thing was in Hindi. It was not in English. Thank you very much. May I now invite our friends from Phopal, Ru Chen Lin, who would like to come and to speak here to take us through two video presentations. This is being done on behalf of Honorable Dr. Hong Tautz, President of Phopal from Taiwan.
Dear Dr. Josh Gandhi, Your Excellencies, and Honorable Chief Judges and Judges, good afternoon. On behalf of Federation of World Peace and Love, Association of World Citizens, Taijiman Qigong Academy, we are honored to be invited here by Dr. Josh Gandhi to share an important movement of era of conscience. It's to encourage everyone to speak kind words, do the good deeds, and spread the positive energy around the world. And since launch last year in January, there are over 194 nations, 3,000 organizations have strongly supported this movement. And now, let's watch a show video of Era of Conscience.
An Era of Conscience.
Let the volunteer travel around the world to promote the idea of love and peace. With a similar mind like Dr. Josh Gandhi, Dr. Hong is a longtime supporter of CMS School. So he has prepared a very short video message with all the honored guests here.
Short on time, we will reschedule the message for some other time. I would now like to announce that from 4 o'clock, we are running the parallel sessions, the thematic sessions. The students who have been asked to attend those thematic parallel sessions, they can please go, leave the hall, and go for their parallel sessions with the help of their teachers. Okay? The speech that we were supposed to hear just now, as it is of 11 minutes duration, I have requested the organizers to reschedule another time for it so that we can hear that. But for the time being, we will continue with the rest of our eminent speakers who are sitting on the dais. May I now invite Honorable Miss Justice Dilfuza Salimovna, Judge of the Supreme Court of the Kyrgyz Republic. May I request one of our students of City Montessori School to please garland the Honorable Justice.
Добрый день, дамы и господа. Здравствуйте, дети. Уважаемые участники, позвольте от имени делегации Кыргызской Республики поблагодарить организаторов конференции за приглашение принять участие в работе конференции.
Good afternoon, everyone, the kids, the teachers, and the members of the delegation. I am representing the Kyrgyz Republic, and I welcome you all to the event, and thank you, everyone, for coming.
Следует отметить, что школа Монтессори и лично господин Ганди проводят большую работу в области международного сотрудничества, в области защиты прав человека.
For the betterment of human being, the hard work that has been done by Mr. Gandhi is commendable, and I appreciate it very much.
Конференция проходит в неспокойное для общества нашего время, когда в мире происходят различные катаклизмы. Наше общество на самом деле имеет очаги напряженности, и мы все являемся свидетелями этому.
The conference is being held in the time when the world is suffering from different kind of problems, terrorism being one of them, and Kyrgyzstan is also suffering a similar kind of trouble.
Темы, обсуждаемые здесь, и вопросы защиты прав человека, женщины, ребенка, вопросы защиты мира, вопросы войны очень актуальны сегодня.
We are talking about the problems of safety of the rights of the women, children, and the underprivileged. So these are one of the main topics to be discussed these days.
Киргизская республика присоединилась ко многим международным договорам в области прав человека и проводит неукоснительную политику по имплементации норм международного права в нормы национального законодательства.
The Kyrgyz Republic is partnering with many international agents to preserve the human rights, and they are committed towards working for human rights for everyone.
Как показывает историческое общественное развитие, по сравнению с мужчинами, женщины всегда были менее защищены и всегда больше подвергали дискриминации по сравнению с мужчинами.
As the history suggests, the women have been discriminated all over the world, and the male part of the society have always enjoyed the privilege which have not been there for the women.
Наша конституция закрепляет: никто не должен подвергаться дискриминации по признаку пола. Мужчины и женщины имеют равные права и равные возможности для их реализации.
Our constitution says that no one can have a privilege depending on their gender. And male and female, everyone should have equal rights and freedom and equal opportunities for work.
Если говорить о гарантиях гендерного равенства в Кыргызстане, то мы можем сказать одно. Не допускается объявление конкурса только для лиц одного пола при объявлении на работу в муниципальную государственную службу.
In Kyrgyzstan, there is no vacancy exclusively for any gender, male or female. So they should get the equal opportunities to get into the services.
У нас имеется система квотирования, когда должно быть не более 70% кадрового потенциала коллектива одного пола.
There should not be more than 70% participation of any gender in any of the department of the government services.
И в случае, если по конкурсу на вакантную должность прошли два кандидата разного пола, то при разных условиях, равных условиях, должен быть принят кандидат такого пола, который менее представлен в данном органе.
If two candidates have been finalized and they are of different genders, then the one who has less representation in the society, in the department earlier, will get the preference.
В качестве примера я могу привести такой пример. Судейский корпус Кыргызстана, в нем женщин-судей представлено больше, чем женщин-мужчин.
In the judiciary system as well, today the women have a better share than the male Kyrgyzstan.
у нас поддерживаются народные обычаи и традиции, не содержащие в себе элементы гендерной дискриминации.
We have all the facilities which tries to facilitate the tradition which do not support any kind of a gender discrimination.
Кроме того, в качестве примера можно сказать о том, что в государстве у нас законодательно введены такие меры, как охранные ордера. И за 7 месяцев 2015 года было выдано уже около 2000 охранных ордеров.
If we pay attention to the statistics, on 7 months of the 2015, a huge number of police has been from the female section.
И кроме того, мы уже говорим о том, что Уголовный кодекс закрепляет ответственность за вопросы дискриминации. Но мы все понимаем, что нельзя только законодательно закреплять какие-то вещи. Это зависит от уровня правовой культуры, от уровня правового сознания. И поэтому нужно поднимать вопросы общественного сознания широким вовлечением средств массовой информации.
I'm trying to just make you understand that the problems of discrimination has not been centered only on the legal views, only on the judiciary part, but it should be taken into account on the day-to-day life of the people. It should be in the culture of the society to try and maintain the gender equality throughout our practices.
В заключение хотелось бы поблагодарить школу Монтессори и учеников школы Монтессори, которые поднимают такие важные и актуальные вопросы. Спасибо за внимание.
Concluding this address, I want to thank the school, City Montessori School, and Mr. Gandhi, along with other his colleagues, for organizing this event and raising this kind of an issues. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Like to invite Honorable Miss Justice Cheryl Austin, Judge Court of Common Pleas, 38 Judicial District of Pennsylvania, Norristown, USA, to please address us.
First, giving honor to God, distinguished participants who are here, I'd like to express my gratitude, wherever he may be, to Dr. Gandhi and to members of the CMS community for the invitation. I am really happy to be here. I'd like to bring greetings to you from the city of brotherly love and sisterly affection, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and the surrounding counties. Now, before I go any further, I need to do a brief survey because I want to make sure everybody here understands what I'm about to say. So I want to ask any members of the audience to please stand if you have ever played sports. Doesn't matter what kind of sport. Football, cricket, volleyball, tennis. If anybody's ever played a sport, please stand.
CMS students, have you never played a sport? If you played a sport, you're meant to stand.
Fellow panelists? Yeah, there we go. All right. Okay. Hey. Looks good. So, remain standing. No, please remain standing. Now, I'd like to add, for those of you who are still seated, are any of those members who are still seated, do you drive? If any of those who are still seated, if you drive, please stand. All right, now, if there's still anyone still seated, I'd like to know if you have a computer internet account, like Google, AOL. If you've ever signed on to a computer, please stand.
I'll just translate for those who speak in Hindi. अगर आपने कभी आप कंप्यूटर यूज किया हो तो आप भी खड़े हो जाएं, या अगर आपने कभी कार चलाई हो तो खड़े हो जाएं, या आपने कभी भी कोई स्पोर्ट खेला हो तो खड़े हो जाएं।
Thank you. All right, thank you very much. You may be seated. Now, that gives me a really good idea. First of all, you've been sitting for so long, it gives you an opportunity to stand up and stretch a little bit. So that's the good thing. But it also gives me an opportunity to, I know now that each and every one of you understands the concept of rules. Because to play sports, especially to win when you're playing competitive sports, you have to know the rules. You can't play if you don't know the rules. In the United States, where I am, you have to have a license to drive. And you have to take a test because there are so many rules. You have to be able to stop at the lights and at the signs and drive in your lane. And I don't think I could drive here. But I've had to learn the rules in order to drive at home. Also, everybody here has an internet account. So you know when you click on that I accept button, how many of you actually read the rules? I don't think very many people do, but there are rules there with our acceptance of the internet accounts. So we need laws and rules for our civilized society. If this world, if our world and future generations want to live in peace, we've got to have a civilized society, and in order to do that, we need rules. So, the courts are very important because the courts are expected to enforce those rules. Now, when I was elected in my state of Pennsylvania, judges are elected to the bench. So when I was elected to the bench, I traded my robe of an advocate for one of a judge. When I did that, I gave up certain things because the code of ethics for judges says judges can't lobby. Judges can no longer be advocates for anything. We can still have our own personal thoughts, and we have freedom of speech. We can still say those things that we want to say, but we can't advocate for things. So how can the courts further the mission of this conference, which is uniting the world for children through enforceable world law and effective global governance? I don't know. However, I think that it is a challenging point. I would like to encourage all of the great minds that are present here in this auditorium to incorporate this concern into your discussions throughout the conference. And someone once told one of the young people that was here earlier, we had this discussion about the fact that as judges, we can't really lobby. And it's so hard. Every day on the bench, I see it's so hard to do the right thing. It takes courage. So, you know, consider that in the equation. But I would hope that that whole code of ethics thing would have some, especially for the committee that is designed to further resolutions of this, that they will incorporate that as well. Thank you for this very generous honor to address you.
Thank you so much. A lot of food for thought, especially for our students too, when you have the opportunity to interact. We now will hear Honorable Justice Nazrul Islam Chaudhary from the High Court Division of the Supreme Court of Bangladesh.
Thank you. I am very much grateful to the organizers of the 16th International Conference of Chief Justices of the World, especially to the CMS community under the able guidance of Dr. Jagadish Gandhi, Mrs. Gandhi, and others associated with them. Honorable Chief Justices, judges, students, and legal luminaries from around the world, and other elites attending the conference, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I feel privileged to stand before you to discuss one of the most important issues of our time, uniting the world for children through enforceable world law and effective global governance. This is a wide topic with far-reaching effects for our future. Given the breadth of the topic, I shall focus my discussion on the relationship between international law and domestic law. In relation to rights of children, hopefully by the end of my brief speech, I would be able to highlight A, that global recognition of rights of children has transformed transnational and international law. B, the special laws dealing with children in the justice system are essential as they can have a huge impact in ensuring rights of children. C, that international legal instruments, although not directly enforceable in many countries, can play a pivotal role shaping local laws and meeting global standards in protecting rights of children. D, that leadership role of the courts in upholding rights of children can create a big impact in developing local laws which meets global standards. And lastly, the concert CE, that a concerted efforts of all organs of the state is required to ensure formulation and enforcement of local laws dealing with rights of children. Global recognition of rights of children, if you analyze, then stands the growth of children's rights in international and transnational laws has transformed the post-war legal landscape. There has been a steady growth of major global and regional legal instruments that have contributed to this transformation. There are a good number of international instruments which deals with rights of children. This includes instruments which contain specific provisions in a broader human rights related instrument, that is International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, 1966. For the sake of brevity, I will briefly sketch in broad strokes some of the key provisions of major international legal instruments on children's rights that form part of that landscape in international law. A, Declaration of Rights of the Children, 1959. The preamble to the UN Declaration of Rights of Children, in short, DRC, notes that children need special safeguards and care, including appropriate legal protection before as well as after birth, and that mankind owes to the child the best it has to give, this, and specially calls upon voluntary organizations and local authorities to strive for observance of children's rights. One of the key principles of DRC is that a child is to enjoy special protection as well as opportunities and facilities by law and by other means. For healthy and normal physical, mental, moral, spiritual and social development in conditions of freedom and dignity, the paramount consideration in enacting laws for this purpose is the best interest of the child. A standard echoed throughout the legal instruments on children's rights, among other DRC principles, a child is entitled to a name of nationality, name and nationality, and adequate nutrition, housing, recreation, and medical services. To an education and for handicapped to special treatment. Education and care. Other principles are on protection against neglect, cruelty and exploitation, trafficking, underage labor and discrimination. UN Convention on Rights of the Child, 1989, the Convention on Rights of the Child, that is CRC, is the most comprehensive document on the rights of children and perhaps the most important one as well, based purely on the number of substantive rights it sets forth. It is the longest UN human rights treaty in force and unusual in that it not only addresses the granting and implementing of the rights in peacetime, but also the treatment of children in situations of armed conflict. The CRC is also significant because it enshrines, quote, for the first time in binding international law, the principles upon which adoption is based, viewed from the child's perspective. CRC is primarily concerned with four aspects of children's right, that is four P's: participation by children in decisions affecting them, protection of children against discrimination and all forms of neglect and exploitation, prevention of harm to them, and provision for assistance to children for their basic needs. For the purpose of CRC, a child is deemed as every human being below the age of 18 years, unless under the law applicable to the child, majority is attained earlier. Key accomplishments of the CRC have been described as fivefold. One, CRC creates new rights for children under international law that previously had not existed, such as the children's right to preserve his or her identity, that is Article 7 and 8, the rights of vulnerable children like refugees to special protection, Article 20 and 22, and in indigenous children's right to practice their culture, that is Article 8 and 9, 8 and 30. In some instances, this innovation takes the form of child-specific version of existing rights, such as those in regard to freedom of expression, that is Article 13, and right to a fair trial, Article 14. CRC enshrines in a global treaty right that hitherto had only been found in case law under regional human rights treaties, that is children's right to be heard in proceedings that affect them. Article 12. CRC also replaced non-binding recommendations that binding standards, that is safeguards in adoption procedures and with regard to the rights of disabled children. Articles 21 and 23. Finally, CRC sets forth an express ground obliging states, parties, not to discriminate against children's enjoyment of CRC rights. The rights to practice in proceedings it is argued together with the principles of non-administration article. Because of a mandatory notice, I am to cut short. Therefore, I skip about some part of my writings and then I go to the main part of it. That is the concluding part of it. Yes. I now proceed to the question of reforms. CRC has not as yet been directly incorporated into national law. However, some provisions have been incorporated through the 2013 Act in response to directions of the Supreme Court. May I explain in this connection that in my country, that is Bangladesh, Children's Act 2013 have been enacted with reference to CRC. So, this CRC is a response to the directions of the Supreme Court. It was done. For example, following the recommendations of the court in the Metropolitan Police Commissioner, that is the State versus Metropolitan Police Commissioner, reported in a law journal, that is 60 DLR 660, it is stated, case the Children Act was repealed and replaced. There was a Children Act in 1974 in my country that has been repealed, and then Children Act 2013 came into place. The preamble to the Children Act states that it has been enacted for the purpose of implementing CRC, and the new provisions reflect some of the provisions of the convention. In addition, it appears some provisions have been incorporated in response to directions of the Supreme Court, as well as the requirements of other international instruments, such as the Beijing rules. Some of the provisions of Article of the 2013 Act deals with probation officers. Then, National District and Upazila Child Welfare Boards in my country, that is Bangladesh, then Child Affairs Desk at every police station, then Children's Court, then participation of child during proceedings, bail of children in conflict with the law, restrictions on sentencing. There is a restriction also in respect of children under the law enacted in my country, that is Bangladesh, that is Children's Act 2013. Now, with regard to legal representation also, there is a provision. An establishment of child development centers is also required under the law in my country. Now, in the conclusion, with the new act in place, a lot still needs to be done to ensure proper enforcement of the 2013 Act. In order to ensure proper implementation of the Act, the government needs to set up the Child Affairs Desk and appoint Child Affairs Police Officers in police stations, establish sufficient numbers of safe homes and certified institutes. Perhaps most importantly, the government ought to set up children's court at every district as envisaged by 2013 Act and reframe the rules under the Act. Now, lastly, I shall conclude by saying that City Montessori Schools has convened this conference, and the dream, as I have seen, the dream that they have dreamt, and the idea that they cherish, I find and I hope, I believe, and I pray that a day is not far away, their dream will be fulfilled. Ideas will be implemented and cherished desire will be achieved by them. With this hope, I conclude. Thank you very much.
May I now invite our chief guest of this session, His Excellency Sir Rodney Lawrence Williams, Governor General, Antigua and Barbuda, to address our gathering. Please join me in welcoming him.
Thank you very much, Madam Chairperson. And let me just break a little bit with protocol to salute Dr. Jagdish Gandhi and Mrs. Gandhi and family, because without them we may not have been here today at this very important conference. Distinguished delegates on the platform, Your Excellencies, Honorable Chief Justices, other distinguished members of the legal profession, staff, students of the City Montessori School, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. This afternoon, I'm deeply honored and humbled by the opportunity you have given me to address this august body on the occasion of this 16th International Conference organized in Lucknow by the City Montessori School. I wish to thank the people of Lucknow and Delhi for the very warm welcome and the overwhelming hospitality that they have shown to my delegation and myself since arriving in India. And to say also, I have been very impressed by the very genuine welcome and the beauty of the welcome that has been shown us by the City Montessori School. I think you should give yourselves a round of applause. I also wish to express my delight in meeting representatives from so many countries and cultures of the world and to learn about their countries and also share mine. But I must commend Dr. Gandhi, his administrators, principals, teachers and children for organizing such a world-class conference. And I want to say that the display that I experienced in this hall last night is one of the best I've seen anywhere in the world. In addition, your outstanding passes in the 2015 exams speaks to the quality of teachers that you have in your school, speaks to the intellect of your students, and speaks to the commitment to excellence in education which the Sinti Montessori School has here for you, and we applaud you for that. I want to say this evening that when I was asked to give this address, I had some concerns, because as a medical doctor with no legal experience, I wondered how I would address you. However, I propose to use, therefore, for the context of this discussion, the overall mandate given to this organization about 16 years ago. And it instructs that you, and I quote, strive to discern ways and means of promoting international peace and security, of promoting equity, freedom, and justice by fostering cooperation and positive collaboration between and among as significant as possible a responsible plurality of the world's capital, comprising nearly 200 nation states, whether they be large or small, developed or developing, military powerful or weak, of diverse religious, cultural persuasions and the like. End of quote. Today's theme, you have heard over and over, speaks of uniting the world for children through enforceable world law and effective global governance with reference to Article 51 of the Indian Constitution. I wish to point out that there is a very strong link between the overall mandate of this year's theme. Additionally, our world today continues to face a vast array of problems and issues that require sound political will and enhanced cooperation among nation states, perhaps through further and improved international agreements or through already established international institutions, reformed as necessary to meet the challenges, or even through such new international institutions as may be deemed necessary with an aspiration of unity. At this point, I would like us to ask ourselves some questions about an imagined united world. Does this mean absence of territorial integrity and independence? Or rather, does it mean greater interdependence between countries? If our answer is further interdependence, to what extent does this unity accept diversity? Does it see diversity as a problem, or does it accept its value and indeed complexity? Does unity mean arriving at a harmonious place where social and cultural norms coalesce like pieces of a puzzle, which have unique features but still fit into a bigger picture? To be more pointed, should a united world be threatened by the territorial defense of social and cultural practices, some of which may be deemed to have a negative impact on the well-being of children, or should it embrace the totality and indeed safeguard the United Nations Convention on Human Rights? In addition, what system does the united world to which we aspire embrace? Is it socialist? Is it democratic? Is it monarchical, communist, Marxist, or various combinations and permutations of one or more of these singular forms? Which has the most potential to support our aspirations? These are very important questions which we need to ask ourselves. The Clark-Shun Plan, devised by two Harvard law professors, Grenville Clark and Louis Son, and published in a book entitled World Peace Through World Law in the 1950s, was based upon a number of principles, inclusive of the principle that general world peace depends on an effective system of world law, which can ensure complete disarmament and institutions clearly setting out the law, courts applying it, and police enforcing it. My invitation to you, therefore, is to reflect and discuss the merits and demerits of the principles, giving particular attention to their potential to direct our challenging journey towards the changes we wish to leave as a legacy to our children. The 1995 Commission on Global Governance, Our Global Neighborhood report, opines, and I quote, "Governance is the sum of many ways individuals and institutions, public and private, manage their common affairs. It is a continuing process through which conflict or diverse interests may be accommodated and cooperative action may be taken. It includes formal institutions and regimes empowered to enforce compliance, as well as informal arrangements that people and institutions either have or agreed to or perceive to be in their interest. At the global level, governance has been viewed primarily as intergovernmental relationships, but it must now be understood as also involving non-governmental organizations, NGOs, citizens' movements, multinational corporations, and the global capital market. Interacting with these are global mass media of dramatically enlarged influence." End of quote. This underscores that governance is broader than government and state actors, encompassing the functions of private and social actors in the definition and implementation of societal goals and public policies. It necessarily operates at multiple levels and in overarching ways. Distinguished delegates, this brings us to another central question. Are effective governance and enforceable world law essential for the changes we pursue in the form of a united world? We accept that some of the most difficult issues facing national governments are global in nature. Then effective governance must of necessity allow for each and every nation to work together. So whether the nation be one of the smallest, like Antigua and Barbuda, or one of the largest, like India, participation is required of all nations. Far too long, our children, who are indeed our future, and have remained invisible in the debates about how our countries are governed, they now must be included in it. As a result, if we omit them, we do them and ourselves a huge disservice. Involving children in discussions about and actions that support governance will help the realization of their rights. This in itself is a key indicator and a measure of good governance in support of more effective states, especially in challenging environments. Crucially, it will equip them to take on the mandate of responsibility, the mantle of responsibility that adulthood confers, and therefore contribute to sound and essential succession planning. As already indicated, the world in which we live is beset with problems, many of which are man-made. We simply cannot just wish them away, nor can we, in good conscience, pass them on to our children. While children constitute 34% of the global population, children's rights all too often fail to be included. When children's engagement becomes systematic and leads to fundamental, structural, and lasting changes in policies and practices, when we have built sustained and meaningful partnerships of adults, young people, and children that allow for a myriad of opportunities to participate collectively in governance, we will be at the point of recognizing them as fully human and with distinct interdependent rights and invaluable potential as change agents. Turning now to the theme of enforceable law, in his seminal book, How Nations Behave, noted Columbia University law scholar Professor Louis Henkin observed at the time of his publication in 1968 that almost all nations observe almost all principles of international law and almost all of their obligations and almost all of the time. This is heartening, and I would argue that the observation makes a strong case for enforceable law, since the system of international law serves the practical interests of states and other international legal entities. With respect to the second obstacle, the tendency of the overriding national interests to create wide mistrust within international organization hinders the formation of effective mutual agreements. Striking examples are the recent conferences about climate change and environmental sustainability, and the discussions about how to deal with the international economic crisis. Therefore, though intentions are still promising, action is lagging, and disorder pervades the international system of governance. The concept of global governance and enforceable world law needs to be given greater attention, and therefore our focus on this is commendable. There is an acknowledged complexity, but it is the only realistic manner of operating and thriving for collective benefit in a more complicated, globalizing, and interdependent world. In recent decades, there has been considerable international attention on the child and their rights in society. It is clear that concern for the rights of children is an integral part of the international community's stated purpose of contributing to peace and security, to promoting international collaboration in matters of education, science, and culture, and to further respect for justice, the rule of law, and human rights, along with fundamental freedoms. It appears to me that to the extent that member states are signing on to a platform of international agreements that recognizes a standard for fundamental and other rights of children, as well as a standard for health services, for education, and for freedom from poverty, wherever they may live, is a step in the right direction towards uniting the world for children. I say this because unity requires a shared and agreed platform. According to Dr. Gandhi, he says unity involves a binding threat and a common concern. While the convention does not explicitly refer to governance, and the United Nations Committee on the Human Rights of the Child really mentions this concept, the convention formulates the basis for the integration of governance. I offer a brief caveat on the attainment of a unified world for children. If we fail to achieve the goals of international peace, security, equity, justice, and sustainable development, any hopes that we may wish for protection and improve well-being of the children of the world will have been shattered. Quite simply, these are preconditions and prerequisites. Of special reference to our children, not only to the UN Convention that seeks specific protection for them, but also the Millennium Development Goals in pursuit of international peace and security, sustainable environmental and social development, poverty reduction, and education. All the 189 of the UN member states signed this Millennium Agreement, and these, of course, have been recently revised into 17 Sustainable Development Goals, and the progress on these have been mixed. Absence of a feasible financing plan for funding the achievement of the development goals is a relevant issue. Indeed, we should bear in mind the vexed and complex crucial issue of global resource disparity as we seek ways and means of encouraging the international community of nation states to strive and stride towards international peace and security and towards international justice, equity, and fair play, and towards a better future for our children. It is noted that the City Montessori School, with its history of education, that appears to offer much in terms of the holistic development of the child, has been playing a vital role in the organization of these conferences. As we all grapple with identifying and understanding the major obstacles that continue to deny large numbers of the world's children the opportunity to experience a sound education, the poverty that envelops them in their homes, communities, or countries, the issues of culture and religion, particularly for girls, were highlighted and discussed, as was absolutely the scarcity of financial resources in some countries as a whole, and failure of governments to prioritize expenditure on facilities such as schools, teacher training, child health, to mention a few. In Antigua and Barbuda, during my tenure as Minister of Education, an education levy was introduced to make up for the financial shortfalls in the education system and level the playing field. This resulted in improved educational attainment for all children. Another dimension of the education issue is the relevance and efficiency of the many teaching tools and methods that we employ in our struggle to optimize our children's educational development. Over the next few days, we should be pondering the constraints that stymie the provision of even a basic education to the children of the world. And perhaps we should be assessing the scope of international cooperation towards a positive collaborative focus on eradicating literacy. Such is the background against which we must do our best. We must dig deep for answers that will help us to create as solid as possible and a concordat amongst the plurality of the nations of the world. Before I draw to a close, I consider necessary to recognize that there exists an array of proposals, literary, mystical, abstract, and admittedly, in some cases, pragmatic, that purports to promote the way forward for a new world order. But we are not prepared to recognize principles such as the rule of law, concepts such as humanism or fundamental rights and nonviolence must all be inherent conditions of any system of world government that would stand any chance of bringing any significant measure of peace, security, and justice to the world community. In the context of our theme today, I observe that the efforts of this conference to date are clearly seen as being channeled through the UN and its several supporting agencies. The UN is far from perfect, but as a vehicle for fostering peace and development, it has a lot going for it. I hope that at the end of our deliberations, you would have agreed with this view and decided to make optimal use of a reform of the UN wherever possible. I am conscious, and I speak to you in the year that marks the 800th anniversary of the Magna Carta, widely recognized as a precursor to the Human Rights Act. The Human Rights Act has made many challenges, but thrives and develops in unanticipated ways, and in doing so, fills me with hope and confidence that based on collective and continuous efforts, we will find the fruits that can nourish and sustain us all, first and foremost, our children and their children and beyond. In closing, let me again refer to the central point. If we are to unite the world's children, then the justice system must be inherently linked to the implementation of human rights standards and the Convention on the Rights of the Child, which have set an important platform for advancement. The rule of law and good governance serve to act in a way to preserve a future to which we can all, especially our children, look forward. I believe that in the context of world governance, the process of attaining centralized power and control may prove to be arduous. We recognize that the fundamental requirement in the quest for peace and prosperity is an appreciation of the diversity of cultures and religions that abound. Harmony, not conflict. Negotiation, not confrontation. Principles, not power. Such are the prerequisites for the pursuing peace, prosperity, justice, human dignity, global partnerships, and sustainability of our planet. The big question we are grappling with is, can we unify the world in the interest of our children? I believe we can. And in the words of India's own Mahatma Gandhi, it says, and I quote, if we are to teach real peace in the world, and if we are to carry on a real war against war, we shall have to begin with our children. May our deliberations be truly inspired and successful. I thank you very much.